Welcome back to Let's Play Disco Elysium Blind. It's raining. Let's get inside this bookstore and take a look around. Yes, that's what we're doing. Talking to strangers and exploring. Alright, so that's what's her name? And that's Mother. Plenty of stuff. Let's look around a little first. Gift books and molten candy. There's an upstairs. Old sports magazines tucked away in a dark corner. The book collects the national receipts of Arda. They are all about lake trout. Hello.
Welcome to Crime, Romance, and Biographies of Famous People. My name is Plaisance.
Plaisance. Okay, the clerk extends a greeting. You know, I want to bump the voices up.
Be welcome. And please take responsibility for the energy you bring into this space.
I'm going to just ask her for money straight off. So, are you the owner of this store?
I am. The proudest owner of our little shop of culture.
Her voice, high-pitched, sounds familiar. You've talked to her before, through the doorbell. Your daughter is the one standing outside the store, right? Annette, yes, my daughter. I hope she wasn't slacking off again with her nose in science fiction. Tell me, was she at her post, doing her job like a proper girl? Yes, of course. Wonderful. Did you talk to her? Yes. Great. On a scale of 1 to 10, how compelled were you to buy books after talking with her? God, lady. Empathy says her opinion of her daughter depends on how well she lured you into the store. 10. She's certainly very polite and helpful. My precious, her dedication brings joy to my heart. She's immensely satisfied with the answer. If you have children, I hope they turn out as great as my Annette. All this pressure has made her really anxious. You know she's been chewing her nails? God, ugh, I told her not to do that. It's such a disgusting habit. Her voice is firm. She'll get over it. Anxiety is a part of life. Empathy says a part of hers, too, clearly. I don't think she can do anything about it. She can if she has enough willpower. This is what's called growing pains. Life isn't easy. Life doesn't give breaks. Kim says, come on, ma'am, it's obvious she can't do anything about it. You're placing an unnecessary burden on a young child. What you're doing is wrong. Even I know that, and I usually don't know anything. She stands stiff and severe, silently fuming. 10 or so seconds pass without change. Rhetoric says she's looking for one, but there simply aren't any good arguments for being an asshole. All of a sudden, she exhales sharply, her shoulders slumped down. Oh no, she mutters. Hold on, I need to invite her inside and apologize. She must be freezing out there. There, she returns with a nod. I don't know what to say to you. My husband, he tries to teach me business lessons. I have what my mother called a dull mind. All this stress. She stops, but her mouth keeps moving. Empathy says, it sounds like both the husband and her mother treat her the way she treats Annette. You're like Annette to her, to your husband and your mother. Oh, she nudges her glasses nervously. Well, my mother was horrible, of course. Absolutely perverse energies around that person. But my husband, she shakes her head. Empathy says, my husband is completely different, of course. Is she an only child? Yes, I'm afraid so. A real treat she is. It would be nice if she had... She pauses for a second. No, we couldn't have afforded more children, really. Not in this economy. Why not? We're quite busy people, you know, my husband and I. Quite busy. Her voice wavers a bit. Children are a lot of work. You don't look like a father, so I don't expect you to understand. She catches herself at an impoliteness. I'm sorry, I'm sure you do understand. She told me she doesn't go to school anymore. Plaisance, I'm saying that right, I think, nods. She's been too busy helping me here, so she studied at home this trimester. This is a temporary solution, of course. I assure you, I, of all people, understand the importance of education. She'll be back in school the moment the store takes off. If that happens, logic says, and hell freezes over? Never mind, it's not a good topic to get into. Is this husband Annette's father? Yes, my husband is a successful entrepreneur east of the river. If only he were more involved in the business we're running up here, she says gloomily. No matter, soon we'll both be off for Grand Coron. Wait, Grand Coron? What's that? It's a proper place to live, one of the most peaceful neighborhoods east of Jamrock. You may know it for its massive housing projects. Most of the buildings are empty at the moment. Her smile is wide. It's a great opportunity to get ahead of the crowds. Better times ahead, for sure. And your husband's also involved with the bookstore? He made the initial investment. Since then, he's been what you might call a silent partner. Rhetoric says, super silent, almost inaudibly so. All right, I had something else in mind. The woman looks aloof, her features much softer. Occasionally she glances at her daughter's silhouette. What if I want to buy a book? Then why are you talking to me? Everything is on the shelves to browse. Don't you feel compelled to buy anything? She fiddles with her pendant, then waves her bony fingers directly at you. See those shelves there? Go. Be drawn. Be drawn. What types of books do you have? Everything is on the shelves. Take a look yourself. She nudges her glasses. The shelves compel you, don't they? All right, I'll take a look then. She smiles and nods, seemingly relieved. Farewell for now, book peddler. All right, so we can actually interact with this stuff here. And then there's an upstairs. Man from Heimdall series. The display rack is brimming with worn paperbacks featuring an extremely muscular sword-wielding barbarian on the cover. Nearly all the titles contain the word Heimdall somewhere. Look through the display of books. Rows and rows of Heimdallermen blur your vision. You make out some titles, Man from Heimdall and the Mammoth Raiders, Man from Heimdall, Return to Heimdall, and the solipsistic Man from Heimdall and the Heimdall Man. Good God, how many are there? Maybe 100? Man from Heimdall and the Sages at the End of the World, Man from Heimdall and the False God, the Scorched Earth, the Heimdall Colonies, Man from Heimdall and the Swamp Beast, and the Snow Crabs, is that all? Not even close, Man from Heimdall in Hell, and the Forest of Slaves, Under the Lake, Heimdall Burning. There's even the Trial of Death, a pastoral combat game book set in the world of Heimdallerman, and so much more. Pain threshold. Storekeep, tell me about the Muscle Man books. Oh, Man from Heimdall? A very popular series of adventure novels. She looks at the book with some disdain. They're awfully immoral and violent books. Why are they so popular? Blood and violence, scantily clad women, epic narratives, all those mystical things he encounters, they're bound to grab those with little imagination and nothing to do. Sounds good. Which one should I start with? What does it matter? They're all the same. She rolls her eyes and fiddles with her pendant. However, the customer is always right, they say. If you're a novice of the series, I'd recommend Heimdallerman, The Men from Heimdall. It's supposed to be a good introduction to the series. I'm not going to buy anything yet. I have to pay my tab at the hotel. Do any of the books call out to me? Pain threshold. Failure. Nothing of interest. Only silence and the cosmic background pain radiation. Okay, so this one is different? No, they're both the same. This one and this one are the same. Okay. What else we got? We got this in the middle. And then we could talk to Annette again if she has anything new to say. Mountain of Board Games, a small mountain of colorful board game boxes. There are numerous types of games for all ages. A lot of shelf space seems to be taken up by Wirral-related merchandise. Look through the pile of Wirral-related items. An endless variety of source books, lore books, and codices litter the table. The topmost book is titled Welkin Compendium, 2nd Edition. There's also a large, hardbound tome with intricate cover art, The Hunters of Catuac, Boreal Creature Compendium, and a pick-your-path adventure game book titled Tales of Wirral, Cavern of Velcrag. Conceptualization, books in a board game section? Who wants to read books? Anything that really catches my eye? There's a box that says Wirral, 3rd Edition Mega Setting Supplements Module. The side panel notes a fantastique adventure board game, new maps and miniatures. A sticker on it displays 25 real. Logic says that price is steep, but then it's a 3rd Edition Mega Setting Supplement, so it makes sense. Storekeep, what board games do you have here? Wonderful board game, sir. The Viticulturist is a classic for sure. Or perhaps you'd like Archipelagos of Insulind? A very educational game for those interested in geography. Rob Ritter is a fun game of economic competition, but can get quite intense after a while. We have games for the whole family. You can play with your children. Inland Empire says, who are you going to play board games with? Do you have friends or family? Wow, I have children? A family? Damaged morale. Oops. It certainly feels like whoever you are will die with... whatever you are will die with you. I don't feel as if I have any kids. Friends are technically like family. She fiddles with her pendant, thinking. For playing with friends, I'd recommend Suzerainty. It's a civilization-building game where you build a civilization, then set off to brutally colonize and repress other civilizations. It'll cost 12 real. Yeah, I'm not buying this. I can't anyway. So what about all these Wirral things? Lousy aura's there, she shudders. No role-playing games are popular among those types, you know, who are into those kinds of things. Personally, I don't like it. Oh, no. Role-playing games are popular among those types, you know, who are into those kinds of things. Personally, I don't like it. Not at all. I've heard they turn people into occult enthusiasts, that they have rituals where they try to summon entities. Highly immoral stuff. You can still buy them, though. She looks at the table, crossing her arms. I'm sure you won't actually mind if I bought them. See if Annette has anything new to say.
I'm sorry, sir. I can't talk right now. I'm very busy with my homework. I have so much homework now.
Empathy says, you just can't win. Logic says, out of the rain and into the gutter. What are you doing now? Math. She looks into her notebook with trepidation. It's really difficult, like, really. They say you need it to get rich. Better than standing outside in the cold, I guess. Suddenly she smiles and perks up, remembering something. Oh, I found something while you were away. What is it? Dick Mullen's hat? I thought this would fit you. She gives you a hat, almost exactly like the one Dick Mullen wears on the covers. Like thanks for helping out. Not me, the city, I mean. Like a detective does. Wait, where'd you get it? Just what Dick Mullen would ask. She lowers her voice. I got it from behind the curtains. I'm not really supposed to go there. It's a fedora? Maybe? It's the hat Dick Mullen wears all the time. She grins with joy. You'll look way more serious with that. Suddenly she looks back at the infernal scribblings under her nose. Right, I have to get back to my homework now before Mom notices. Man, this is hard. Suggestion. What are you missing here? Why does this feel familiar? Success. Because you know each other. She's been talking to you so openly because you've talked before. Hang on, so you know me? We've met before? Yes, I used to stand out there all the time before Mother told me to focus on my homework. You've been running around all week without your shirt on, sir, telling people about being a star or something. I don't really understand who those stars are. Oh my god. Did I ever talk to you? Of course. You stopped by a few times. She looks at you intently. You certainly look better than the last time I saw you. Thanks. I'm trying. Yeah, I can see. You don't have party eyes anymore. Party eyes. The lieutenant slowly, ever so slowly, realizes something. Party eyes. Yes, of course. That makes sense. Esprit de Corps says, I'm not surprised children have seen you running around with party eyes on, he thinks. Not at all. Party eyes? You know, like a cat in the dark, all big and wide-eyed. She giggles at the thought. It certainly looks odd on a man. Composure, says the swiveling eyes of a loony drug addict. That is what she meant. You were probably gurning, too. What's gurning mean? Electrochemistry says, hell yeah, you should get some party eyes right now. Snap those sequins on, you boy. Does that mean I've been partaking in narcotics? Electrochemistry says, oh baby, that's not what you have to worry about. Worry about the important thing. So why didn't you tell me you knew me to begin with? I didn't know I had to do that. She looks puzzled. Thanks. I've learned something about myself today. I'm glad I could help you, sir. She smiles a wide, helpful smile. All right, see you around, Annette. Okay, now we got this hat. Dick Mullen's hat. If anything, this wide-rimmed hat looks even better than the hat Dick Mullen wears. Dick Mullen is stupid and not even real. You're real. Your brain is real. Your real, real brain is inside the hat. Gives us plus one encyclopedia somehow. There we go. Awesome.
I put it on. Hi, detective. Are you here for more books?
She smiles warmly. I thought she would say anything. She'd say something when I had the hat on, but nope. Oh, this was probably their living quarters. Let's go up here first before I mess around with that. It's probably about all the entire episode just looking around this bookstore. Shelf of crime novels. These shelves are overburdened with books from the same series. You see the name Dick Mullen over and over. Look through the display of books. Crime fiction is a disgrace, an asinine misrepresentation of the physical attributes and the arduous everyday work of actual police officers. These books greatly overstate the excitement of police work, glossing over how long it takes to actually follow up on leads and eliminate dead ends. What's more, they completely ignore the psychological hardships of, year after year, coming into contact with people during the worst days of their lives. Not a single mention of all the stress this work creates upon the officer's family. Detective fiction just doesn't feel like truth at all. Now, would you like a list of books found on the shelf? Sure thing. You see, Dick Mullen on the Job, Get Me Mullen, The Stalwart Adventures of Richard P. Mullen, Dick Mullen and the Murder in the Orchard, The Sordid Affair of Dick Mullen, A Killing is Declared, Dick Mullen in the Murder House, The Final Case of Dick Mullen, an obvious lie, Dick Mullen in the Clock Tower, The Ordeals of Dick Mullen, Dauntless Dick, Dick Mullen's Funeral Pyre, The Murder of Dick Mullen. Dick Mullen dies? Oh no, it turns out he faked it to solve a case. Are there any more? Yes, there's also The Dame Who Did It, Farewell My Mullen. Faking death seems to be a common trope in the Mullen series. The Morbid Tales of Dick Mullen, A Dark Tide Turns. Tragedy Calls for Dick Mullen, another one with fake death. And of course, Dick Mullen the Murderer. In order to catch a murderer, Dick Mullen must become the murderer. Inland Empire says, after all this, you still haven't found the answer to the one question that matters. Who is Dick Mullen? Alright, yeah. Reaction speed. Who is Dick Mullen? Success. Your quick eye notices a small caterpillar crawling across the spine of a book. The title reads, Dick Mullen and the Mistaken Identity. What do we have here? Mistaken Identity? A worn paperback from Dick Mullen's classic Hard-Boiled phase. The premise seems to be that Dick Mullen is framed for the murder of his best friend and has just a few days to prove his innocence. Why does this speak to me? Could it be the motifs of unstable identities and shocking betrayals? No, it's got to be something else. Perhaps you're drawn to the dark and noirish atmosphere? No, that's not it either. Is it because the smoking dame in the slinky red dress on the cover is giving you a hard-on? What? No, that's not what's happening. Yes, it is. The bulge in your pants is embarrassingly obvious. Well, good thing we're up here, away from the kid. Electrochemistry says relax. It's not that bad. Also, that means your blood flow is returning to normal. Good news, really. Something the matter, detective? Kim says. Nope, all good here. Casually adjust your pants. The lieutenant nods. You think you detect the faintest trace of a grin on his face, but you can't say for certain. Storekeep, what's all this crime fiction? Oh, crime, robberies, murders. She lowers her voice. Even sexual crimes. We're fortunate to have Dick Mullen and his stories to sort all that out. You're a police officer, apparently. You should buy all of these. They really do teach a person how to be a proper detective. Yeah, right. A quaint picture book brochure. Very colorful. It's a tome of fascist magic. Rather candid. Everyone knows the most interesting thing about fascists was their magic. Really? Is that sarcasm? Shelf of biographies. The plaque on the shelf reads Biographies of Famous People. You see a large variety of names, none of which ring a bell. Look through the display of books. Browsing through all the books with all their names makes your head spin. None of these seem important or relevant. It's all just vapid egoism. Suddenly, a particularly odd title catches your eye. It reads, High Speed Love, The Tragic True Love Story of Jacob Eyre and Alfie Delatraz by one Cecilia Averbrook. What's it about? High Speed Love chronicles the romance between two of the finest tip-top tournée racers in history. One of them is the madcap driver Jacob Eyre. I-R-W. I do not know how to pronounce that. His blonde mane graces the cover. Next to Eyre's life story, you see a slim biography of an Occidental rock star called the Anti-Star. Anti-Star? He's famous for shooting morphine into one of his eyeballs and cocaine into the other. Oh my god. Next to that, Revacholian radio personality Guillaume Bevy stands in front of a run-down drug den. He's a permanent fixture on Channel 8, reporting on real-life crime and ruining cops' days. Plaisance says, I really must insist you buy one of the books. You're interrupted by the shopkeep. Reading them is not for free. Do still browse, though, but not too long. I'm sorry, I did not mean to rush you. You are browsing. Go ahead, take your time. Time is commerce. Anything of note in this shelf? I would say... The woman hums to herself, The greatest innocence. Yes, most certainly. It's an important educational tool, delving into the depths of history, religion, and their relation to innocentric power. Who or what is an innocence? A very influential historical figure, but surely I don't have to tell you that. She waves her hand as if casting aside the thought. You're a law officer, and law officers have at least some education. The book is also very daring. The author aims to re-examine the universal understandings of the innocentric system, creating a fresh vantage point and a shift in the tired order of things. I thought it was about which of these innocences is the coolest and greatest. Perhaps for a layman, she scoffs. Deep analysis is necessary to peel back the multi-layered meanings. Conceptualization says, Do her words seem vague and abstract to you? So you recommend it? Certainly. It's prudent for a person to have at least an elementary understanding of history and society. Imagine the chaos we'd be in otherwise. Inland Empire says, You feel like you should get this one. Definitely. It's important somehow. There is something personal inside. I can actually get this, but we need to pay our hotel bill. We won't have a place to sleep tonight. So I want to save my money. However much I have. Oh, I guess this is my money, right? 505. We owe 30, though. Yeah. This is going to be a problem. Alright, what's here? Wait a second. Before I do that, I keep forgetting. I want to put the voiceover volume up even more. Okay, almost all the way up. Because I think it's a little low compared to my voice, right? And we seem to be having no problems whatsoever with performance, so I'm going to put the anti-aliasing up to 8 and see how that works. Hardcore mode. Maybe on another playthrough. Doing that mostly to save my settings. I don't think it's necessary. What's this? Map wall. Several maps have been attached to a bulletin board hidden inside the alcove. They're held up by small pins. The board has come loose from one corner. The maps look old and faded. Your eye catches a map of Insulind, a map of Revachol, and a map of Martinez. So look at Revachol first. The north coast of a verdant island is shattered by the delta of a river. It is the River Esperant. Countless bridges put the shards back together, connecting city blocks to river islands. La Delta says a great artificial heart in the center, teeming with life forms and construction. To the east, rolling hillsides, Le Jardin, Stella Maris, the suburbs of Saint-Baptiste, swallowed up into the megacity. They sound rich to you. This is Revachol East. And west of the river? Coron. It's somewhere to live. Not bad. Then there's Jamrock. It's bad. People shouldn't live there, but they do. Then Farberg. It's almost as bad and much larger. Then Coal City. It's the worst. And Martinez? It's so small you can't even see it on the map. No, wait. There it is. North of Jamrock, the strip of coast next to the Greater Revachol Industrial Harbor. It looks downright despondent. It's almost Coal City, to be honest. Volition says, no, this is somewhere to be. This is all you have, but it's still something. Streets and sodium lights. The sky, the world. You're still alive. Look at the map of Insulind. This large map displays archipelagos. You see a constellation of small dots on the light blue emptiness of the Insulindic Ocean. The largest in the northeast is Le Kelu. You are here. Another, far away in the southwest, Semenes Islands, Île de Fantôme. What else? Ozone, Laurentide, Face la Mer. I'm doing my best with this. Archipelagos, North Arcade Islands, all just specks of dust on the vastness of the Insulindic. On the edges of the map, the color fades into a blur of dotted lines, black and white. Visual calculus says, disintegrating into mathematics. Inland Empire says, in the northeast, a dust mite stands on the north coast of Kelu. In a bookstore. It's you. Squint first. Can you see cities on the islands? You can. On Kelu, Revachol, a single black star. On Ozone, Fond de l'Air and Vermandor. On Vermandou? On Archipelagos, Croyant, Moraine, Villers, on Cementine, Olduvai. And on Laurentide, Diora of the Seven Seas. Empathy says, lost little pearls of light. Tiny fires in the dark. Encyclopedia says, 850 million people live on these little dots, an oceanic world of culture and commerce torn apart by history. Look at the edges. The ocean breaks apart into a tangle of cosines and azimuths, all pointing into pale nothingness. Mundi is the north azimuth. That means world, actually. Grad is the northeast azimuth. Doesn't that mean village? Samara is the east azimuth. Sol is the west azimuth. Isolas, they're called. Inland Empire says, connections to other worlds, worlds past the Insulindian, unknown to you. You only know you've never been there. Encyclopedia says, you have little idea what they are. Distant stars? Gods? But looking at them makes you feel almost non-existent. Whatever they are, the Isolas are immeasurably large compared to you, and very, very far away. Perhaps they are gods, conceptualization says. Gods of distance and outer dust. Look up the map of Martinez. It's not really a map, it's a tourist thing. A picture postcard with buildings on it, drawn from an isometric perspective. A date in the upper right corner says 48. Still, it's detailed. Could be pretty useful for scouting ahead. You see the jagged boxes of an industrial harbor, even the whirling rags there. Storekeep, can I buy these maps? I'm sorry, officer, the map of Martinez is the only one available. The other two are not for sale anymore, and besides, you could scarcely afford them. They're quite valuable, though they might not look it. The map of Martinez is 90 cents, though. Why is the one of Martinez so cheap? That old thing? It's an out-of-date map of a tourist location that never was nor came to be. From when some design studio people tried to spruce the place up 4 or 5 years ago, they also renovated the horse statue, set up those coin-operated viewers, and designed the new street lamps. Rhetoric says, the place does not look like a successful tourist trap, does it? What happened then? They didn't get far, for some reason. A shame the project never got going. Would be nice if someone fixed Martinez up. All these ruins are bad for business. I'm going to come back for the book that seems really important to me and the map of Martinez. I'm not going to steal it because we don't have a good chance and she's probably going to catch us. And then we might not be able to come in here anymore. Another boring book just discarded here. Okay, this is the last display that we can look at. Shelf of Paranormal Books. This bookstore is not strictly about crime, romance, and biographies of famous people. There's also a wide range of paranormal literature. Look through this shelf. Amidst the various books, you find one written by someone named Matthias W. Dundas. It's about wholeness, unity, balance. Rhetoric says, these three things are very important to the working class mind. The point of the book and many others on this shelf is to give people medicinal advice in situations where they don't have access to paid health services. How does that work? It serves platitudes while also telling everyone that traditional medicine, the kind people don't have access to and which costs more than this book, is garbage and would only give you cancer anyway without even curing your cold or anything. Wow. Wholeness, unity, balance, on the other hand, can basically take care of anything, though it is important to note when it's up to your mind to heal yourself, then it's because of your mind that you're ill in the first place. Does the book say anything else? The book features chapters on topics such as how to find magnesium. It even lists plants you can harvest magnesium from, how to continue drinking if you're an alcoholic who has destroyed his liver. And there's even a chapter on the ancient Sarayese tradition of using duck gallbladder preservatives to treat and prevent sexually transmitted diseases. Pre and post factum apply. Nothing worth buying. Inland Empire says, this is just mundane garbage. What's even paranatural about this? Storekeep, what books are these? Sir, please, no browsing in that shelf. She narrows her eyes. That wisdom is not for free. I can't have you end up, like, opening a police store next door and stealing my customers. Oh, no. Let's use our Inland Empire to try to find something truly otherworldly. Success. The throbbing in your head increases with every passing moment you gaze at this shelf. Suddenly, as if out of nowhere, a small green book becomes apparent. The title of it reads Medicinal Purposes of the Pale. What's the pale? The book contains very little explanation on the matter. This knowledge seems to be taken for granted. Surprised my encyclopedia aspect or skill isn't helping me with that. What's this book about? The book contains descriptions of various pseudoscientific therapies, alternative medicines, and folk remedies involving the pale, also known as le territoire. For example, it recommends vigorously swatting one's naked body with a venic, or hand broom, made from the leafy twigs of a young birch tree from the near pale. Sounds painful. It is supposedly invigorating and good for the circulation. What else? It also recommends consuming distilled spirits like vodka or whiskey that have been aged in the pale. Readers are instructed to cover these jars in a shallow hole just inside the pale and leave them there for 30 to 60 days, depending on the potency desired. And what does this pale aged liquor do? Among other benefits, it is alleged to restore a damaged liver to perfect health. That could be valuable to me. But logic says that seems improbable. How is that possible? Is it any more improbable than anything else than human beings put their faith in? Fair enough. What else is in there? For general health and well-being, readers are encouraged to take regular strolls through the pale, though a sidebar cautions readers to limit each stroll to less than an hour. These strolls promise to cleanse the mind of worries and the body of toxins, especially if the perambulator performs this ritual in the nude. Nudity figures prominently in a number of these prescriptions. Inland Empire says this is exactly what you need. Anything else of note? There's an entire section devoted to cures for men who are struggling to perform their marital obligations. Well, I certainly don't need that. You close the book and return it to its place on the shelf. We could buy this as well if we could spare the money. I mean, we technically can buy it, but we need to pay our hotel tab, like I've been saying. The only thing left, I know we're getting late in the episode here, is to check back here. She's probably not going to like that, though, but I'll just say, my bad. I just thought there was more of the store. Closed curtains. You see a set of tattered curtains blocking the way to another room. A strange cage-like trinket dangles from the curtains.
Excuse me, officer. The back room is strictly for employees only.
Plaisance calls out from the counter. Shopkeeper, what's behind the curtains? Nothing. Now please go back to browsing books. She fiddles with her pendant. Don't you feel compelled to look at the books? The books are all you care about.
Okay. All you need is like a stopwatch to swing back and forth.
Conceptualization. She speaks as almost as she's trying to put a spell on you, urging you to buy more books.
Or any books, for that matter.
Oddly enough, the more she tries to draw you away from the curtains, the more alluring they become. Examine the strange cage-like trinket. You see some kind of charm, an irregular polyhedron, assembled from bones, sticks, and straws. Inside, a disturbing fish head with empty eye sockets stares at you. Encyclopedia says, from the looks of it, this is a traditional Seminese ward, meant to provide protection against ill luck, bad dreams, curses, and other supernatural scourges. And who are the Seminese? Inhabitants of Ile de Fantôme, the Seminine Islands down south. Aside from poking at it, suspiciously, there is nothing else to do with the fish head charm at this time. The curtains remain shut before you. I don't want her to kick me out of the store, so I do want to come back and get those things, so let's ignore the curtains for now. I want to see what's back there, though.
Good day to you. Well, I don't know if we should finish looking around here. But we'll be doing that next episode anyway. Thanks for watching, guys. See you in the next episode, where we hopefully get more interesting things done. See you next time, and always seek adventure.